وَإِذَا قِيلَ انشُزُوا فَانشُزُوا يَرْفَعِ اللَّهُ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا مِنكُمْ وَالَّذِينَ أُوتُوا الْعِلْمَ دَرَجَاتٍ وَاللَّهُ بِمَا تَعْمَلُونَ خَبِيرٌ.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأفضل الصلاة وأتم التسليم على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. الحمد لله الذي أنزل الكتاب على عبده ولم يجعل له عوجا، والصلاة والسلام على خير خلقه محمد، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. We'll continue our course about تفسير جزء عامة، and inshallah we'll talk about Surah Al-Duha. So I read the Surah and please repeat after me. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. والضحى والليل إذا سجى ما ودعك ربك وما قلى وللآخرة خير لك من الأولى ولسوف يعطيك ربك فترضى ألم يجدك يتيما فآوى ووجدك ضالا فهدى ووجدك عائلا فأغنى فأما اليتيم فلا تقهر وأما السائل فلا تنهر وأما بنعمة ربك فحدث. This surah, brothers and sisters, and the next surah, they are special surahs. They are different from all the previous surahs. These two surahs, Surah Al-Duha and Surah Al-Sharh or Al-Inshirah, both of them addressing the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So every ayah in them talking directly to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Surah Al-Duha talking about an occasion happened in the life of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and Surah Al-Inshirah also linked to the life and the da'wah of Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam. Now there is different narrations about the revelation of this surah. Imam Ahmad recorded from Jundub that he said the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam became ill, so he did not stand for prayer for a night or two. Then a woman came and said, "O Muhammad, I think that your devil has finally left you." So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. By the forenoon, by the night, when in darkness, your Lord has neither forsaken you nor hates you. Other narration, Bukhari, Muslim, At-Tirmidhi, and An-Nisa'i, Ibn Abi Hatim, Ibn Jarir, all recorded this hadith. This Jundub who narrated is Ibn Abdullah Al-Bajli. In a narration from Al-Aswad Ibn Qais, he said that he heard Jundub say that Jibreel was slow in coming to the Messenger of Allah. So the idolaters said, Muhammad's Lord has abandoned him. So Allah revealed, وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. Now, let us try to understand the situation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the atmosphere of this surah. We know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala started to reveal the Quran to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam through Jibreel when he was in the cave of Hira, when Surah Al-Alaq, Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, revealed to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And after that, the wahi continued to come to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, according to this narration and other narration, the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was ill. And one of the narrations said that he had a little injury in his foot. And because of that, he was unable to stand for Qiyam for 2 nights. Now, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what he used to do in his Qiyam, because the people are asleep, so when he praying at night, he will pray in a loud voice. And so the people will hear what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is reading. Now, every time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam reading something new, so the people, they can understand that there is something new revealed to him. And the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is saying to them that there is a revelation coming to me. Now, for 2 nights, according to this hadith, there is some narration saying 12, something 15. The main idea is that al-wahi didn't come for a certain period of time. It's 2 or 5 or 7, doesn't matter. The main matter that al-wahi stopped coming for a certain period of time. So what happened? The Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, according to this narration, he didn't read. So what these people who are surrounding Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or the neighbors, they thought, oh, this means there is nothing new that Muhammad will stand and pray and read now. This means that the wahi who comes to him, and in their explanation, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punish them with what they deserve, they said, you're double. So shaitan, he didn't come to you now. So in Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he heard that, he was a little bit upset. Because, you know, the meeting between Jibreel and Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was something special and strange, and no one can imagine, you know, the happiness of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when he used to meet Jibreel alayhi salam and receiving the Quran from him, because he knows that Jibreel now revealing the verses from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the verses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would like to say to Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam. So Muhammad alayhi salatu wa sallam was upset because of this situation, that the wahi stopped for a little while. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he knows what's in the heart of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And Ibn Abbas reported, when the Quran was revealed to the Messenger of Allah, Jibreel was delayed from coming to him for a number of days. Therefore, the Messenger of Allah was affected by this. Then the idolaters began to say, his Lord has abandoned him and hates him. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. Now let us see now what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here made oath by. So we have وَالضُّحَى. What's وَالضُّحَى here? So, and duha here is related to shams and the nur, the light. Then he said, وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى, by night with darkness. Now we can remember now the occasion that these two ayahs revealed before, or the reason for this revelation. So the wahi in itself, the Risala, the message of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is it nur or not? It is life. In itself, life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, Allah waliyu alladhina amanu yukhrijuhum min al-zulumati ila al-nur. Allah is the friend, the supporter of the believer. He will take them from darkness to into light. والذين كفروا the kafirs, أولياءهم الطاغوت, their friends, supporters, الطاغوت, the jinn, the shaitan, يخرجونهم من النور إلى الظلمة. They will take them from light to darkness. So there is a link between the duha and the nahar and the light. And here there is a link between the duha. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose here of duha because one of the best times that you can see the sun shining and the light everywhere is that time, duha. It is the same of the nur of the deen. And when this nur comes to the heart, then this nur will reflect on the face, on the actions, in everything. Everything will be nur, everything will be light, everything will be good. وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى And by night when it's darkness. Now imagine the situation Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when Jibreel delayed for some days. So here سَجَى can mean three meanings. Can mean sukoon, which means still, and can mean covering, and can mean started, or can mean that stop, there is cut. So we know that the layl, the dark, will cut the noor. So when there is nahar, when there is day, what will cut and cover this noor? The darkness. And in the day, the people, they are going, moving here and there. But what is when it is dark, when it is night time, the people become quiet. So here, layli idha saja, by the night when it darkens. Similar to this, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose this, similar to the situation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when the wahi stopped for some days. When the wahi, when the link between Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is through the wahi, stopped for a little while. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose these two words here, al-duha and al-layl idha saja, to describe the situation of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he revealed, received the nur. The nur revealed to him al-duha. And suddenly that duha stopped. That nur stopped. So he was in darkness. He doesn't know what's going on. So is this means that he's not a prophet anymore? Is this means that Jibreel is not coming anymore? So Muhammad ﷺ became worried that now, and this is the darkness he lived during these days, that he was upset, he was sad because of that. So وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose these two words, and no other words can describe the situation of Muhammad ﷺ. And it is as saying to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, "What duha by the forenoon, the noor which started will continue, and no more darkness now. It will be only noor, because from now on the wahi will continue, and the noor that you are carrying will be spread to the whole world. And alhamdulillah, we are among the people who received the nur of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I'm not talking here about the nur of his spirit. I don't want someone to take my words and then say, Sheikh Ahmed today became Sufi and start to talk about the Noor of Muhammad. I am talking about the Noor of the Risala, the Noor of the message. I'm not talking about the Noor of the person. I'm not saying that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is Noor. Please be sure that I'm not saying this. I don't believe in this. I believe that the Noor, the light, is the message in itself. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is a person. He's a messenger. He doesn't know the ghaib. He doesn't know the unseen. Unless Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala told him about something. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam did. He's not alive anymore. He's in his grave. He doesn't come on a Friday to the masjid and listen to the khutbah. He doesn't sit there. So all these things, we don't believe in it. We believe that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is a prophet. He died as a normal person. As Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, he said, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا لِبَشَرٍ مِنْ قَبْلِكَ الْخُلْدِ أَفَإِنْ مُتَّ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ. We didn't make it for any person before you that he will live for eternal, and no one will be live for eternity. So everyone will die. And Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala said, وَمُحَمَّدُ إِلَّا رَسُولٌ قَدْ خَلَتْ مِهِ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ الرُّسُلُ فَإِنْ مَاتَ أَوْ قُتِلَ انقلبتم على أعقابكم. So Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is only a prophet, and if he dies or he being killed, don't go back on your heels. And Allah سبحانه وتعالى said clearly to Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, إنك ميت وإنهم ميتون. You will die and they will die. So this is something we have to be clear about it. So here, just when I'm talking about the Noor, I'm talking about the Noor of the message, not the Noor of the person himself, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sallam. So وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to him, مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. Your Lord has neither forsaken you nor hates you. In this Allah is swearing by the forenoon and the light that he has placed in it, that Allah neither forsaking you nor hates you. And look at the words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose. Very beautiful words. First he said, ma wada'aka. Al-wada' in Arabic, when you say the word wada', it will be between two people, they love each other. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose this word here, ma wada'ak. Because if a normal person leaves, you don't bother about if he stays or he. You'll bother and you are sad if he or she leaves, if you love these people. This is what we call wada'. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said here, ma wada'aka. So he didn't forsake you. He didn't say to you, goodbye, this is finished now. Then he said, Rabbuka. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose here the name Rabb. We know that there is 99 names for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala used here the word Rabb. And the meaning of Rabb is Lord. And it gives a lot of meaning. It gives the one who created you, the one who provided you, the one who loves you, the one who sent you, the one who taking care of you. It is as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, remember, I am your Rabb, I am your Rabb, I am your Lord. How I will leave you? How I will forsake you? How I leave you alone? I am your Rabb. And he said, Rabbuka. So he linked this calf, which is the pronoun here with this noun, to say your Lord. He didn't say to him, مَا وَدَّعَ رَبُّ الْعَالَمِينَ Muhammad, the Lord of human beings. There is difference of saying رب العالمين and ربك. There is here a special touch that I am your Lord. You are my messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam. ما ودعك ربك وما قلى. So قلى means hate. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here appreciated Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in every word in this ayah, brothers and sisters. First, when he said to him, ما ودعك, he didn't forsaken you. Then when he say قلى, and قلى, so if you look at the two verbs here, ودعك and قلى, so let me go to just some Arabic grammar here. So ودع is a verb, and the كاف here in ودعك is the object, we call it مفعول به in Arabic. ودع كاف, forsaking you. But when it comes to قلى, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say قلاك, hate you. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he doesn't like to mention the name of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this situation. Allah doesn't even to say in the word in itself that it might happen. He didn't say قلاك, hates you. He said hate. Without mentioning the object here, and this is type of appreciation in Arabic when you don't say the object in this matter. So he didn't say to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't hate you. He said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't hate. Without mentioning the word kaf here, which means you, which is raising the status of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam more and more. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he's Arab, and when he received this ayah and he understood it, ما ودعك ربك وما قلى, he didn't talk say قلى محمد, he say وما قلى, hate, that because of your high status Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't mention the object here, which is the kaf, the letter kaf, which means you. ما ودعك ربك وما قلى. So he raises, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raised the status of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in this ayah twice, and he linked him with the name Rabb to show him that your Lord will not forget you, your Lord will not hate you, because he is your Lord, the one who sent you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. And indeed, the hereafter is better for you than the present. Now al-akhirah here, Ibn Kathir, when he spoke about it, and other mufassirin spoke about al-akhirah means the hereafter. And there is other mufassirin, they said al-akhirah is not limited here to the hereafter only. It means that everything coming, everything coming from today is better than the present. And think, brothers and sisters, how these words work with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam at that situation. A prophet, he just started his mission. The angel Jibreel stopped for some days or some nights. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to him, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-akhirah is better than the present. He's telling Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about what? Akhirah and the future. And this is good news about what? The da'wah. It is making Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam now 100% sure that this da'wah will succeed. He's saying to him, the future for you, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and your da'wah is better than the present. And obviously, in the hereafter, will be better than the present, what you are facing now. So this ayah is a glad tiding to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that your da'wah will succeed, you'll be more believers, you will inshallah establish a state, you spread the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and there is many people will follow you and convert to your message, which is Deen al-Islam. وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. So الآخرة, if we took the opinion of الآخرة, this means that we are limiting the ayah to just to say it is only the hereafter. But here الآخرة means the coming. Everything is coming will be better than this. And that was happening. So from that day, yes, they suffered, but the price for this suffering was the successful that they had later when they managed to establish the Islamic country in Al-Madinah. Then after that, they managed to spread the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala all over Arabia at that time. So Ibn Kathir seeing here, meaning the abode of the hereafter is better for you than this current abode. For this reason, the Messenger ﷺ used to be the most abstinent of the people concerning the worldly things, and he was the greatest of them in his disregard for worldly matters. This is well known by necessity from his biography sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the Prophet was given the choice at the end of his life between remaining in this life forever and then going to paradise or moving on to the company of Allah, he chose that which is with Allah over this lowly world. Imam Ahmad recorded that Abdullah ibn Mas'ud said, the Messenger of Allah was lying down on a straw mat and it left marks on his side. Then when he woke up, he began to rub his side. So I said, O Messenger of Allah, will you allow us to spread something soft over this straw mat? He replied, مالي وللدنيا إنما مثلي ومثل الدنيا كراكب ظل تحت شجرة ثم راح وتركها. I have nothing to do with this world. The parable of me and this world is like a rider who rests in the shade of a tree. Then he passes on and leaves it. So this is how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam understood this dunya. A passenger is riding, and in his way there is a tree. He sat under that tree for a while, then he left and continued his journey. And all of us in this life are the same. We came, we work, we do our business, we do different things. We just shade this dunya for a while, then we'll continue our way to al-akhirah when we leave this dunya. So here it is saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَلَا الْآخِرَةُ خَيْرٌ لَكَ مِنَ الْأُولَى. Now the next ayah giving more glad tidings to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. And verily, your Lord will give you so that you shall be well pleased. Meaning in the final abode, Allah will give him until he pleases him concerning his followers and that which he has prepared for him from his generosity. from this will be the river of Al-Kawthar. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Inna a'tainaka Al-Kawthar, which will have domes of fluid pearls on its banks, and the mud on its banks will be the strongest fragrance of mist, as narrated in the hadith. This is Al-Kawthar. The banks of it will be pearls, and the mud in itself will be the fragrance of misk. The Messenger of Allah was shown that which his ummah would be blessed with after him, treasure upon treasure. So he was pleased with that. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. So Allah will give him in paradise 1 million palaces, and each palace will contain whatever he wishes of wives and servants. This was recorded by Ibn Jarir and Ibn Abi Hatim. Now, let us look again at this ayah. وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose the way. So he started with saying sawfa. Sawfa in Arabic, when you see sawfa in front of any verb in Arabic, this means this verb in the future. Sawfa or sa. So when you see sawfa in front of any verb in Arabic, this means this verb will happen in the future, in mustaqbal. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying here to him, to Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, sawfa. This will happen in the future. Yu'tika. So the word yu'ti means to give. And there's in Arabic there's different words for giving. So there is yu'ti and yu'ti. But yu'ti, if you use the word yu'ti again to give, the one who is giving here can take it. So as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, يؤتي الحكمة من يشاء ومن يؤتي الحكمة فقد أوتي خيرا كثيرا. So الحكمة something Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala can give and he can take if he likes. But العطاء, when you give in this way, this means that you will not take back. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose the verb here يعطيك, that I will give you this and all these bounties that I will give you, and I will not take it back from you. وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ. Who will give you? Here, after يُعْطِيكَ, يُعْطِيكَ whom? رَبُّكَ. Again, remember, your Lord. And فَتَرْضَى. So you reach the satisfaction situation. And how Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam will reach the satisfaction? When he is sure that this ummah or the people became Muslim, that these people, they are practicing their deen. And Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when he was ill, In the last days, in the last day of his life, he stood up and took like the curtain and looked at the Muslims while they are praying, and he smiled. He was happy over what he has seen, and that minute can translate to us this word, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. The Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, after suffering 13 years in Mecca and the first 6-7 years in Medina, because we have to remember, brothers and sisters, that establishing the state in Medina wasn't the end of suffering. It was a new suffering, actually. Because the kafir, they didn't leave them alone. They tried to kill them. They attacked them in Badr, in Uhud, in Al-Ahzab. They sent even people, you know, tried to assassinate Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So they used different types against Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He granted Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam the conquest of Mecca in the 8th year of Al-Hijrah. And Mecca liberated from the idols. You can imagine around the Kaaba, which Ibrahim alayhi salatu wa salam built that Kaaba to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then these people changed it to worship what? Idols. Not only one idol, two, three. 360. You can imagine how awful these people. 360 idols around the Kaaba in different shapes. Big, small, medium, different. And they give them everything. Like the Buddhists these days. You'll find there's this big statue of Buddha, and the people go there asking for help and giving the presents and food and all these type of things. And there is people dedicated there. So you know these people, you will find them shaved head with this special clothes there. Just they spend their life for this statue, subhanAllah al-Azim. How ignorant these people. How come you are a human being sitting there serving a statue? And you'll find the Hindus there doing the same. I remember maybe 15 years ago now. You know the statues that the Hindus they have, and some of them they might made from clay. And you know the clay absorbs the water, and if you put water or it or so what happened at that time? This is 95, I think. It seems that some of these Hindus in South Hole by mistake milk dropped on that statue, so the statue absorbed the milk. So they will look, oh, this means he's drinking. They put more, drank more, and then the news started to go everywhere in South Pole. And one of my friends at that time, he was living there, he said, you go to the supermarket, there is no milk. Because you know South Pole full of these handles. And they take it, and it was in the news. I saw it in the news at that time, and in the newspaper talking about this. And what the whole issue about, that a clay statue absorbed the milk. And you'll find the people, they go and worship all these things. So the people at that time, you know, used to worship all these idols. And Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he conquered Mecca, so he managed to demolish them. And he used to say, جاء الحق وزهق الباطل إن الباطل كان زهقا. The حق, the truth came, and the باطل, the falsehood, has vanished now, and it is a vanished matter. So, and he demolished all of them. So this was a victory, not for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself only. It was for Muslims and for the deen, because these idols was preventing the people from seeing the right idea of Al-Kaaba. The people going there and start, instead of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were worshipping these idols. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in his life and after his life until he is satisfied. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make this da'wah everywhere. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala defeated these kafirs, and 2,000 of the people in Mecca, those who used to torture Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and used to trying to stop Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from spreading the da'wah, these people became Muslims now. And Muhammad, many of them, they are also, when we come to the human part of it, many of them, they are the relatives of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The people Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he grew up with. And they are his relatives, they are his people. He likes them to be Muslims. He doesn't like to see his uncle in the hellfire. He doesn't like that. He doesn't like to see his neighbor in the hellfire. This is not, as a human being, and as a prophet, this will be more and more, because he doesn't like to see any of the people he can convince to be in the hellfire. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this ayah, every word in this ayah mentioned, it was applied 100%. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَالَمْ. Let us go back, brothers and sisters, to the beginning of the ayah. وَالضُّحَى وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the night and the dark. Then he said to him, مَا وَدَّعَكَ رَبُّكَ وَمَا قَلَى. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he hasn't forsaken you. He doesn't hate you. And the future or the hereafter will be better than the present. All these ended by وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَعْلَى. Now this statement in itself is enough for the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is not working for himself. He's working for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for this great deen. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying to him, يُعْطِيكَ. And here يُعْطِيكَ includes everything. Talks about the followers, talks about spreading the deen, talking about the power, everything. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he promised him that in the future he will give you until you are content, you are satisfied, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala fulfilled this promise. And the minute he died, he saw by himself that Muslims, they have Imam, he's Abu Bakr, he will be the Khalifa, and they are praying behind one Imam. Mecca liberated, the Arab around, in the Arab peninsula, they are Muslims, it's purified from the Mushriks. So what he needs more than this? So all the things that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam in his life was looking for, spreading the deen, seeing the deen strong, seeing people praying, practicing their deen, he saw it in his own eyes while he's alive. So Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam smiled when he saw this, and when he saw Muslims that are praying behind Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. What a beautiful thing, or a beautiful scene that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam can see when he see Muslim, they are practicing this deen in this manner. So when he died, this word was there, فَتَرْضَى. He was satisfied, content of what he has seen from his ummah. وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Now, after that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam three examples of how he favored him. What are the things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a proof to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the previous ayah? So in the previous ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala spoke about the future. He said the last two ayahs, الآخرة, then وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. Now Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the coming three ayahs spoke about the past and the present. And he started with the first problem Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam faced. What was the first problem that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was faced? And alhamdulillah, maybe most of us have been orphaned, but I saw myself people who are orphaned. And it is not about the money, it is about the emotions, the kindness. Maybe sometimes if the father died, then the uncle will look after his nephew. Do you think the love and the emotion that the father can give is the same that the uncle can give? No. Again, if the mother died and the father married another one, doesn't matter how religious is that woman, how kind, how lovely she is, she cannot give the same emotions. Because brothers and sisters, these emotions in the heart of the parent is something unique. You cannot feel it exactly. You cannot understand it until you become a father or a mother. Because when you are children and the father shouts at us or say, don't do this, so why they are saying this? Why are they doing this? And sometimes the children, they think that their parents, they hate them. And I'm telling you, as a father and a grandfather, it is impossible that your parents will hate you. Maybe they will hate some of your actions. Maybe they will be angry for something you have done. But when they are angry, they love you so much. When they are happy, they love you so much. Even if they punish you from their love, not from their hate, because they love you. Because they can see something you cannot see. If you are going astray in a wrong way, and they are so angry, they'd like to stop you from this, maybe they grounding you or not allowing you to go out or these things. Not because they hate you, they don't like you. No, because they love you so much. They care about you. They don't any harm to affect you. This is why they are doing these things. This is why they acting in this way. Because this comes from their love. Allah installed this love in the heart. This is why you will find the mother, you know, doing everything for her child. Breastfeeding, staying at night, changing the nappies, everything. They are doing this for their child, free of charge. They don't, no one of them, they're paying their mother, say, okay, you looked after me 10 years, okay, this is for every year, £1,000, take this £1,000. Sometimes the parents, they say, just please be quiet and we are happy. So this is when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminding Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about the first thing, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. So he was orphan from his father's side when he was, before he was born. And then when his mother was, when he was 6 years old, his mother died. So now he's orphaned from the two sides. And you can imagine at that time, and he's not a rich person. So his uncle, his grandfather Abdul Muttalib looked after him. And really Abdul Muttalib was a great man. And the way that he treated Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was excellent. And he used to say that my son, when he talked to him about him, he was not my grandson, Hafidi. He would say, Ibni, Innabni, Sayakun lahu sha'un azim. My son will be something special in the future. He would be a great man. Because he was a great man himself, Abdul Muttalib. He was a great man, a great leader. And when he spoke about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, my grandson, but he didn't say my grandson, he said, my son. This is how he used to talk about him. And even he used to allow him to sit in his bed or couch near the Kaaba. No one allowed to sit there. Then Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as a young boy, come play and jump on that bed. His uncles come to take him, say, no, leave him, leave my son. He will be a great man in the future. He was looking, he is a wise man. So Abdul Muttalib treated him in very nice, beautiful way. Then when he was 8, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, again Abdul Muttalib was died. Then Abu Talib look after him. And Abu Talib treated Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a very beautiful way. Even after he knew from Buhayra, maybe you know the story when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went with his uncle in a trip to Syria, and in the way they stopped near a monk called Buhayra, and that Buhayra, he noticed that there is a cloud covering the caravan, so this is something strange. So he called them and he checked Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he found that Khatam al-Nubuwa, the mark of prophethood, on the back between the shoulders of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Then he said to Abu Talib, this boy will be a prophet. So, and if the Jews will see him, they will kill him. So take him back. So Abu Talib, he took Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or arranged for Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam to go back to Mecca. You know what, after that, what he used to do, Abu Talib? So he used to have many children. So Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam will sleep in this place now. So after he will sleep in that place, at night he will come and carry him and put him somewhere else. So even if someone is watching to see where is Muhammad to kill him, because he believed what Buhayra said, that the Jews might kill him. So he used to do this every night. See how care Abu Talib, the care that Abu Talib gave to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Not only this, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam became prophet, he didn't believe in him. But when the Quraysh, they decided that they abandoned all Banu Hashim, all of them, they went to Sha'b Abi Talib, that area where Abu Talib was there for 3 years. And they suffered with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Not all of them believers, but Abu Talib, he protected Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And when they came to Abu Talib and asked Abu Talib to say, look, Abu Talib, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is talking bad about our idols, or about our gods. Just give him to us, we'll deal with him. He said no. And he said to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, go continue your da'wah, and I will not hand you to these kafirs at all. And he was the supporter of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam all his life, until he died in the 10th year of the ba'ath of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here reminding Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of this. أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. Did he not find you an orphan and gave you a refuge? This refers to the fact that his father died while his mother was still pregnant with him, and his mother Amina bint Wahab died when he was only 6 years old. After this, he was under the guardianship of his grandfather Abdul Muttalib until he died when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was 8 years old. Then his uncle Abu Talib took responsibility for him and continued to protect him, assist him, elevate his status, honor him, and even restrain his people from harming him when he was 40 years of age, and Allah commissioned him with the prophethood. Even with this, Abu Talib continued to follow the religion of his people, worshipping idols. All of this took place by the divine decree of Allah, and his decree is most excellent. Until Abu Talib died a short time before the Hijrah, after this Abu Talib death, the foolish and ignorant people of the Quraysh began to attack Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So Allah chose for him to migrate away from them to the city of Al-Aws and Al-Khazraj, among those who helped him in Al-Madinah. Allah caused his sunnah to be spread in the most perfected and complete manner. Then when he arrived at their city, they gave him shelter, supported him, defended him, and fought before him against the enemies of Islam. May Allah be pleased with all of them. All of this was from Allah's protection for him, guarding over him, and caring for him. So this is just to remember what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى. Now, after you become, so they call you yatim until you become about 18 years old. So after that, you are not a team anymore. So when you are able to work, So you are not yatim now. So you are adult, you are independent. Then when you are independent, what do you need? You need guidance to know what's the right, what's the wrong. Then the second ayah came. وَوَجَدَكَ ضَالًّا فَهَدَى. He found you unaware and guided you. This is similar to Allah saying, وَكَذَلِكَ أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ رُوحًا مِّنْ أَمْرِنَا مَا كُنْتَ تَدْرِي مَا الْكِتَابُ وَلَا الْإِيمَانُ وَلَكِنْ جَعَلْنَاهُ نُورًا نَهْدِي بِهِ مَنْ نَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. And thus we have sent to you a ruh from our command. You knew not what is in the book, nor what is faith, but we have made it a light wherewith we guide whosoever of our servants we will. So here the scholars, when they spoke about Dal and Fahda, some narration that one day Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam went astray in Mecca, and then they found him. And another narration that one day he was on a trip to Syria, and the camel went astray, then the angel Jibreel brought him back. But the understanding of this, the word of Dal, the one who's going astray, or the one who doesn't know the truth. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about Nasara, for example, Ad-Dallin. Why? Because they don't know the truth. They don't know that Isa alayhi salatu wasalam is a prophet. He's not God. So most of them, they don't recognize this, and they just consider Isa as God. This is where the misguidance came. So Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, before he was 40, he has no idea about what the deen is. He was trying to understand. This is why he used to go to the cave of Hira. So that period of time, when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to go to Ghar Hira, it was a contemplation. He's thinking about the creation. He's thinking about the heaven. Who created this? What's the right deen? So until that time, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't give him the guidance. He was preparing him. He prepared him in different ways. Until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, according to his knowledge, knew that now this is the time for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to start his mission. Then he sent Jibreel alayhi salam to reveal the first ayahs of Surah Al-Alaq. So وَجَدَكَ ضَالًا فَهَدَى. So who gave you the guidance? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَوَجَدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. And he found you poor and made you rich. Meaning you were poor, having dependent. So Allah made you wealthy and independent of all other besides him. Thus Allah combined for him the two positions, the one who is poor and patient, and the one who is wealthy and thankful. In the two sahih, it has been recorded from Abu Huraira that the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم said, ليس الغنى عن كثرة العرض ولكن الغنى غنى النفس. Wealth is not determined by abundance of positions, but wealth is the richness of the soul. Remember this hadith again, brothers and sisters. Wealth is not determined by abundance, what you have, money, of positions, but wealth is the richness of the soul. So you'll find there is people, their soul is rich. They don't have money, but you'll find them better than many people. They are rich, but their soul is poor. So try all the time to be sure that your soul is rich, because the money coming and going. But if your soul is poor, then doesn't matter how much money you have. And here in these three ayahs that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with, when we look at the words فَأَغْنَى أَلَمْ يَجِدْكَ يَتِيمًا فَآوَى, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't say فَآوَاكَ, فأغنى. He didn't say فأغناك. فهدى. He didn't say فهداك. He said فهدى. And here the scholars who dealing with the linguistic miracle of the Quran, they are saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala didn't mention the kaf here, which is the pronoun which means you, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he didn't limit all these things just to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed the Prophet ﷺ with these three things, and then the Prophet ﷺ carried these things out to the people. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to Muhammad ﷺ, yatiman fa'awa, orphan, gave you shelter. And Muhammad ﷺ did the same. He adopted at the beginning Zayd, and he did this to many people after that, and he made this the practice of Muslims. ضَالًا فَهَدَى. He was misguided. He doesn't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided him. And Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the tool in a way to guide the who? All the other people. All the Muslims. Who guided us? Who gave us the huda, the guidance? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guided us through Muhammad alayhi salatu wa salam. وَجِدَكَ عَائِلًا فَأَغْنَى. Also, the Nabi ﷺ, he was poor, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make him rich. And the Nabi ﷺ also, in his life, made many, many people rich by giving them. By giving them sadaqah, by giving them presents. Like, I told you this story before. The man who came and asked the Prophet ﷺ to give him, and he gave him, then he said more. Then he said, okay, look to this valley full of camels and sheep, take it. Imagine, valley full of camel and sheep, then Prophet ﷺ, he gave it to them. And what are the result? All the people of that person became Muslims, because when he explained to them, this is how the Prophet ﷺ giving. So this means he's a prophet. He cannot be a normal person. He will give all this sheep and camel to one person. So this is the linguistic miracle in these things. So الهدى Awa and Hada and Aghna in these ayahs is not limited to you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You will spread all these things to your ummah and also to the future ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala after reminding Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam of these three things, which is very important in his life, then he asked Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam now to act according to these, to act according to these bounties. So what was the first thing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reminded him about? Orphan. So he started with the orphan. So he said to him, فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَخَرْ. Therefore treat not the orphan with oppression. So remember, you were orphan and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sheltered you, protected you. Now you have to do the same. Just as you were an orphan and Allah sheltered you, then do not oppress the orphan. In other words, do not humiliate him, scorn him or despise him. Rather, you should be kind and gentle to him. But as I said, be like a merciful father to the orphan. And the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said in a hadith, the best house is the house where there is orphan and he is treated kindly. And the worst house is the house where there is an orphan and he is treated badly. So this is one of the ayahs which is encouraging us to be nice to the orphan. And there is many ayahs. I just remind you of the hadith when Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he said, I am the one and whose sponsor yatim will be in Jannah like these two fingers. Then after he reminded him of al-yatim, he spoke about wa amma al-sa'il. Now sa'il here we can say it goes to both, to the one to do with الهدى والضلال, which is guidance, and goes to the الغنى والفقر, that you were poor and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made you rich. And repulse not the one who asks, meaning just as you were astray and Allah guided you, then do not scorn the one who asks for knowledge, seeking to be guided. Ibn Ishaq said, وَأَمَّا السَّائِلَ فَلَا تَنْهَرْ, and repulse not the one who asks. This means do not be oppressive, arrogant, wicked, or mean to the weak among Allah's servants. Qatada said this means respond to the poor with mercy and gentleness. Now, many scholars, they said sa'il here means two types of sa'il, asking. So it can be asking for money or asking for knowledge. So if you have knowledge and someone comes to you asking for knowledge, then you have to be nice and gentle and don't push the people are asking knowledge or treating them badly, even if they are asking stupid questions or questions that you cannot imagine. Sometimes the people will ask this question. I was reading the other day about Sheikh bin Baz rahmatullah alayhi, and one came to him and he said, you know, in the Quran Surah Al-Baqarah, the longest ayah is ayah today, the ayah of death. So it is the whole page. If you look, it is ayah, I think, 283. It is the longest ayah. So someone came to him and said, Sheikh bin Baz, what about an imam leading the salah in Tarawih, and he will make this ayah, he will read this ayah in two rak'ah. Because we know that when you read at least, you know, at least one ayah in the rak'ah. But he's asking him, what about someone, he read it in two rak'ahs. So Sheikh bin Baz smiled, this is the narration, he smiled and he said, I haven't heard about this before. So I'm talking about the response of great Sheikh like bin Baz. He didn't say, what's this? You know, why they are doing this? He doesn't know about the Quran. So the response, and even Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, in many occasions, when they ask him, his response will be smiling. Sometimes he will be angry, but his anger doesn't reflect in abusing the people. You will not find in the seerah of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam that the Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam abused a person. And the Sahaba, they are saying, we used to know that Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is angry of something from his face, that his face turned to red. This is how Nabi Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he used to show his anger. So you'll not find the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam swerved at a person if he asked, or even that man who grabbed Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam from his toe until it made the mark on the neck of Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And he said, give me, you're not giving me from your money or your father money. He said to him, okay, just leave me alone. So the Sahaba, you know, when they saw someone grabbing the Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam in this way, some of them, they are ready to kill this person. How you are treating the Prophet ﷺ in this way? But the Nabi ﷺ, he said to them, just leave him, just please, you know, just move your hand from me. And he said, what do you want? And the Nabi ﷺ gave him. If this happened to us, you know, we'd be mad and crazy and fight. So the Nabi ﷺ, in answering the sa'il, the one who was asking, if we talk about knowledge, he was the most noble person in treating the people who were asking. And you'll find the same with our scholars, rahmatullahi alayhim. And I saw this from my great Sheikh, Sheikh Al-Albani, rahmatullahi alayhim. Doesn't matter what the people ask him. He's sitting and talking. And sometimes, when I used to attend his dars, his lesson, you'll find some people, they are asking really awful questions. You cannot believe. And some of them, they were really, they don't respect in the way that they are asking or refuting what he's saying. But despite all of this, you'll find him patient, asking them to sit, and dealing with them, discussing with them in a very professional manner, until some of them, they say, okay, and some of them, they don't want to listen. They say, okay. They just leave. But the one who would like to listen, subhanallah, you'll find them sitting, and they can see in front of them what is the right opinion about this, what the right answer about this, what the right idea about this, and then they will follow. And there's many people, they started, you know, as enemies, and going to Sheikh Al-Albani to just attack him on his views, and turned to be his student, because the manner he used to do. And not only Sheikh Al-Albani, because I'm talking about my own experience, but when you read about the great scholars, you find the same. This is when it comes to the knowledge. Again, when it comes to giving money, now, if someone he asks you for money, if it is a loan, or if it is sadaqah, because there's many people, the smile can worth million pounds. So if someone come ask you for a loan, and you don't have the money, and you smile in their face, and you make dua for them, this is for them better than giving them. But even if someone asks you for a loan, small loan, and when you come take it, I don't know when you will give it back. So subhanAllah, all the time think about فَلَا تَنْهَرْ. Don't be harsh when you give. And if you don't have, just reply with nice words, with a smile. And the end of the surah, وَأَمَّا بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ فَحَدِّثْ. And proclaim the grace of your Lord, meaning just as you were poor and needy, and Allah made you wealthy, then tell about Allah's favor upon you. Abu Dawud recorded from Abu Huraira that the Prophet ﷺ said, لا يشكر الله من لا يشكر الناس. Whoever is not thankful to the people, then he is not thankful to Allah. At-Tirmidhi also recorded this hadith, and he said, this is sahih. Abu Dawud recorded from Jabir that the Prophet ﷺ said, "من أبلي بلاء فذكره فقد شكره ومن كتمه فقد كفره." Whoever overcomes some test, i.e. calamity, and mentions it to others, then he is indeed thankful. And whoever conceals it, then indeed he was ungrateful. Abu Dawud was alone in recording this hadith. So this ayah, talking to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, talk, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose here fahadith. Hadith means keep talking. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala granted you for something, talk about it. Say, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me with this. There is no problem with that. And show that you are thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also by giving. So giving, one of the way of thanking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bounties to you. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you a lot of money, then go and give and donate. So the people will understand that, mashallah, alhamdulillah, you have money. So in this way, you are talking about what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave you. This is Surah Al-Duha, brothers and sisters, a great surah. And it is a message for every one of us. Every one of us, if you have problems, Remember that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not leave you alone if you seek His aid. Allah will not let you down if you are a righteous person. Be on the right path, rely on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not let you down as He did to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. اللهم اجعلنا جميعا من الذين يستمعون القول فيتبعون احسنه اللهم اجعلنا ممن يعملون بالقران واجعل القران الكريم حجه لنا وليس حجه علينا يوم القيامه واخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وافضل الصلاه واتم التسليم على نبينا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه اجمعين